हरे
कृष्णा सभी धनवा प्रभु जी।
हरे कृष्ण प्रभु धन प्रणाम जी।
हरे कृष्ण
हरे कृष्णा प्रभु जी धन प्रणाम। सभी वैष्णव को प्रणाम करता हूँ।
ओम गांतिमरंदस्य ज्ञानांजनाशलाकय चक्षुरोन्मीतं येन तस्मै श्रीगुरवे नमः। श्रीचैतन्यमनोभीष्टं स्थापितं येन भूतले स्वयं रूपद्वयं ददाति स्वपदान्तिकं। वन्देऽहं श्रीगुरुः श्रीयुतपदकमलं श्रीगुरून् वैष्णवांश्च श्रीरूपं सागरजातां सागना रघुनाथामृतं तं सदैवं साद्वैतं सावधूतं परिजनासहितं कृष्णचैतन्यदेवं श्रीराधाकृष्णपादां सगणललिता श्रीविशाखामृतांश्च। नमः ओं विष्णुपादाय कृष्णापेक्षा भूत श्रीमते भक्ति विधान स्वामी नाम में। नमस्ते सरस्वती देवे गौरवाणी प्रचार ने निर्विशेषा शून्यवादि पाशाद स्थान ने वाचा कल्पद रूप कृपा सिंधु पतिता नाम पावने भ्यो वैष्णवेभ्यो नमो नमः। नमो महावदन्याय कृष्ण प्रेम पदार्थ कृष्णाय कृष्ण चैतन्य नाम वर्त से नमः। हे कृष्ण कर्मा सिंधु दीनबंधु जगतपते गोप्स गोपिका कंता राधा कंता नमस्ते। सप्त कांचन गौरांग श्री राधे वृंदावनेश्वरी वृषभानु सुत देवी प्रणमानी हरि प्रिय निवासाय नित्य परमात्मने बलभद्र सुभद्राभ्याम जगन्नाथाय नमः। जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधर श्री वसति गौर मतविंद। हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे 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 राम 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 हरे हरे। हरे कृष्ण So we were supposed to start from which verse?
53 Prabhu.
53. So 53. नाहं वेदेर्न तपसा नादानेन न चेज्जय शक एवं वेदो द्रष्टुं दृष्टवान् असि मां यथा। प्लीज रीड
द फॉर्म यू आर सीइंग विथ योर ट्रांसेंडेंशियल आईज कैनॉट बी अंडरस्टूड सिंपली बाय स्टडीइंग द वेदास नॉर बाय अंडरगोइंग सीरियस पेनेंस नॉर बाय चैरिटी नॉर बाय वर्कशिप It is not by this means that one can see me as I am.
Krishna says here, please understand who desire the goal of their life to see that swarupa of mine cannot see that form by practical like study of Vedas, etc., etc. So by this means, we can't understand Krishna. So Prabhupada writes in the purport, for scholars who have simply studied Vedic literature by way of grammatical knowledge or mere academic qualification, Krishna is not possible to understand. So just by understanding and reading in an academic way, we can't understand Krishna. So here in Calcutta, also in Calcutta University, they also read Prabhupada, this Rupa Goswami books. Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu is a part of their curriculum. So these people, they read about all the higher rasas, which even our devotees don't read. They read after 10, 15 years of practice. So they teach them and they also write answers. Students write answers, score marks. But despite that, they don't even follow 480 principles. They can't even give up eating fish. So that is how academic study is not useful. Similarly, doing penances, etc. By all these things, one cannot understand Krishna because they are more on the material platform. So this verse shows that material piety cannot lead to bhakti. So as we discussed before also, so it is spiritual piety which leads to bhakti, not the material piety. So how do we understand Krishna? Krishna explains in 54. भक्त्या त्वि अनन्या सख्या अहम एवं विदो अर्जुन ज्ञातुं दृष्टुं च तत्त्वेन प्रवेष्टुं च परंतप। प्लीज रीड।
माय डियर अर्जुन, ओनली माय अनडिवाइडेड डिवोशनल सर्विस कैन आई बी अंडरस्टूड एज आई एम स्टैंडिंग बिफोर यू एंड कैन दस बी सीन डायरेक्टली ओनली इन दिस वे कैन यू एंटर इन टू द मिस्ट्रीज ऑफ माय अंडरस्टैंडिंग।
So, भक्त्या त्वि अनन्य सख्या, अनन्य सख्या मीन्स अनन्य भक्ति। सो बाय प्योर डिवोशनल सर्विस ओनली, सो अनन्य मीन्स अनन्य, अन्य मीन्स नॉट बाय कर्म और ज्ञान। सो नो मिक्सर ऑफ कर्म ज्ञान योगा एनीथिंग, ओनली प्योर डिवोशनल सर्विस। सो ओनली बाय अनडिवाइडेड और प्योर डिवोशनल सर्विस लॉर्ड सेज आई कैन बी अंडरस्टूड। सो दिस वन ऑफ द फेमस वर्सेस कोटेड बाय प्रभुपाद एट मेनी प्लेसेस to show that how only by bhakti we can know Krishna. So neither by karma, yoga, anything. And by that one can understand into the mysteries of Krishna. Otherwise one can't understand Krishna. So 54 and 55 have a very powerful purports, although they are long. But we can read them. So somebody can read purport.
Krishna can be understood only by the process of undivided devotional service. He explicitly explained this in the verse so that unauthorized commenters who try to understand Bhagavad Gita by the speculative process will know that they are simply wasting their time. No one can understand Krishna or how he came from parents in a 400 form and at once changed himself into a 200 form. These things are very difficult to understand by study of the Vedas or by philosophical speculation. Therefore, it is clearly stated here that no one can see him or enter into understanding of these matters. Those who, however, are very experienced students of Vedic literature can learn about him from the Vedic literature in so many ways. There are so many rules and regulations, and if one at all wants to understand Krishna, he must follow the regulative principles described in the authoritative literature. One can perform penance in accordance with those principles. For example, to undergo serious penances, one may observe fasting on Janmashtami, the day on which Krishna appeared, and on the 2 days of Ekadashi, the 11th day after the new moon and the 11th day after the full moon. As far as charity is concerned, it is plain that charity should be given to the devotees of Krishna who are engaged in his devotional service to spread the Krishna philosophy or Krishna consciousness throughout the world. Krishna consciousness is a benediction to humanity. Lord Chaitanya was appreciated by Rupa Goswami as the most munificent man of charity because love of Krishna, which is very difficult to achieve, was distributed freely by him. So if one gives some amount of his money to persons involved in distributing Krishna consciousness, that charity given to spread Krishna consciousness is the greatest charity in the world. And if one worships as prescribed in the temple in India, there is always some statue, usually of Vishnu or Krishna. That is a chance to progress by offering worship and respect to the Supreme Personality of Godhead. For the beginners in devotional service to the Lord, temple worship is essential, and this is confirmed in the Vedic literature. Svedeshwara Upanishad 6.23. Yasya deve para prakriti yada deve tata garau tasya deka deha artha prakasyante mahatmana. One who has unflinching devotion for the Supreme Lord and is directed by the spiritual master in whom he has similar unflinching faith can see the Supreme Personality of Godhead by revelation. One cannot understand Krishna by mental speculation. For one who does not take personal training under the guidance of a bona fide spiritual master, it is impossible to even begin to understand Krishna. The word "to" is specifically used here to indicate that no other process can be recommended or can be successful in understanding Krishna. the person Hare Krishna. Continue.
No, no. So I'll just explain this particular purport, very important purport. So in this particular purport, Prabhupada is discriminating between the piety in terms of Vedir, Tapasa and Dana and the spiritual aspects of these things. So whatever is explained in 53, how they are different from those performed in devotional service, Prabhupada is discriminating between both of them in this particular purport. So like reading of transcendental literatures, Vedic literatures. So there is scholarly study and the study of other sections of Vedas which are connected to Karma Kand, Gyan Kand, all these things. And the difference between reading Bhagavad Gita and Srimad Bhagavatam. Bhagavad Gita, Bhagavatam, Chaitanya Charitamrita. So Prabhupada is making very clear initially, if you see, first he talks about Vedir. Vedir means reading of the Vedas. So reading of the Vedas has to be authoritative. It has to be read from authoritative sources. So that is what Prabhupada explains. And it has to be done along with following of the regulative principles. So not just you are reading for academic way, one is also reading for practicing these principles. And like once one of our devotees was reading, studying in a university. So he came to know that there is one person, basically a professor. He did his PhD in Jiva Goswami literatures. So many people in especially Western countries, they do PhD on Jiva Goswami literatures. So he was really impressed and he thought, no, this person, I'll make him meet with Prabhupada. So then he met this person, he told, and this person told that you can come to my house, we'll discuss something from Jiva Goswami literatures. So this devotee became very happy and he went there. But when he went there, he found this particular person sitting on his armchair with a glass of wine in his hands. And then he told, okay, now we'll discuss. And then he told his wife, now can you serve him something? And wife came with meat and eggs. So then he told, I don't take all these things. So then he understood, although this person read Jiva Goswami literatures, but there was no transformation because it was not coupled with practice of relative principles of bhakti. So only those who practice these principles can understand these principles. Otherwise, academic study is like licking the honey bottle from outside, which Bhakti Sanskriti says. So in order to taste the honey, we have to open the bottle and then lick the honey. So similarly, in order to understand these literatures, we have to practice these literatures. So if we don't practice them, we just can't understand them. So this is regarding studying of the Vedas. Then second one is talked about the, in the previous verses, tapasa. Tapasa means penances. So Prabhupada says the penances means doing fasting on Janmashtami, Ekadasi, Gaura Purnima, all these Western days, when we perform the fasting, it is spiritual. Whereas ordinary fasting is so many Indians do. Practically seeing all 7 days, there is some reason for doing fasting. For Hanumanji, there is a Tuesday. For Sunny Dev, it is Saturday. For Braspati, it is a Thursday. So there is some reason for doing fasting every day. So, but Prabhupada is talking about the Vaishnava way or the spiritual way of fasting, by which we get spiritual advancement. So that's regarding Naham Vedir Na Tapasya. But this Sajay Tapasya, it gives spiritual benefit. Ordinary Tapasya doesn't give. Similarly, Prabhupada talking about Na Danena. Danena means charity. So then Prabhupada makes a point that the greatest charity is charity of giving knowledge of Krishna or knowledge of bhakti. Now, So inspiring people to do Krishna Naam and Krishna Katha. So that is greatest charity. And anybody who helps in that charity directly, indirectly, also get the benefit of that spiritual charity. So either by money, one helps. Or anybody who is supporting, like somebody may be doing the cooking. Somebody may be doing the cleaning. So directly, indirectly, anyway, if you are helping in the preaching mission, that is also considered preaching. So that's the greatest charity which Prabhupada talks about. And then worship. So worship, Prabhupada writes, is that worship is worship on temple. So na che jaya. Ijya means worship. So ordinary worship of demigods and other things, so that is gives material piety. But worship of deities of the Lord gives spiritual piety. So that is how things of 53, when they are taken in a Vaishnava perspective, they do lead to understanding of Krishna. So the activities are the same, but if details are different, then the effect is also different. So but Prabhupada says is such a thing can give results only when it is done under the guidance of a bona fide spiritual master. So that's why he quote this verse, yasya deva para bhakti rasa devi tada kuro tasyevte kathita yartha prakasante mahatmana. When one has faith on spiritual master and the supreme lord, and one follows the bona fide spiritual master, then one can get success by performing all the previous activities in a Vaishnava perspective. So whole and soul Prabhupada makes the things very clear. Now we can continue with the purport.
One who has unflinching devotion for the Supreme Lord and his directed.
It is over. Persons for the personal forms of Krishna.
What do you mean?
The personal form of Krishna, the 200 form and the 400 are described as Durdarshanam, very difficult to see. They are completely different from the temporary universal form shown to Arjuna. The 400 form of Narayana and the 200 form of Krishna are eternal and transcendental. Whereas the universal form exhibited to Arjuna is temporary. The word is Tvad Anena Na Drushta Purvanam. State that before Arjuna, no one had seen that universal form. Also, they suggest that among us the devotee, there was no necessity of showing it. That form was exhibited by Krishna at the request of Arjuna, so that in the future, when one represents himself as an incarnation of God, people can ask to see his inner self form. I have to continue, Prabhu?
I continue.
Okay. The word na, used repeatedly in the previous verse, indicates that one should not be very much proud of such a credential as an academic education in Vedic literature. One must take to the devotional service of Krishna only, then they can one attempt to write commentaries of Bhagavad Gita. Krishna changes from the universal form to the 400 form of Narayana and then to his own natural form of two hands. This indicates that the 400 form and other forms mentioned in Vedic literature are all emanations of original 200 Krishna. He is the origin of all emanations. Krishna is the distinct even from these forms. What to speak of the impersonal conception? As far as the 400 form of Krishna are concerned, it is stated clearly that even the most identical 400 form of Krishna, which is known as Mahavishnu, who is laying on the cosmic ocean and from those breathing, Whose breathing so many innumerable universes are passing out and entering, is also an expression of Supreme Lord as stated in Brahma Samhita 5.48. I have to tell Prabhu this sloka.
If you can read very good, otherwise just translation.
Okay. The Mahavishnu into whom all the innumerable universe enter and from whom they come forth again simply by his breathing process is preliminary expansion of Krishna. Therefore, I worship Govinda, Krishna, the causes of all causes. Therefore, one should conclusively worship the personal form of Krishna as Supreme Personality of Godhead. Who has eternal bliss and knowledge. He is the source of all forms of Vishnu. He is the source of all forms of incarnation. And he is the original Supreme Personality of Godhead, as confirmed in Bhagavad Gita. In the Vedic literature, Gopal Upanishad 1.1, the following statement appears. Sachidananda Rupaya, Krishna... Sorry, Prabhu.
Krishnaya Klishta Karine.
Krishnaya Klishta Karine. Namo Vedanta Vedyaye Guruve Buddhi Sakshane. I offer my respectful obeisance unto Krishna, who has a transcendental form of bliss, eternity, and knowledge. I offer my respect to him because understanding him means understanding the Veda, and he is therefore the supreme spiritual master. Then it is said, Krishna vai purnam daivatam. Krishna is the supreme personality of Godhead. Gopala Tapani Upanishad 1.3, Eko Varshe Sarvaga Krishna Idaya. That one Krishna is the supreme personality of Godhead and he is worshipable. Yekopi san bahuda yo vabhati. Krishna is one but is manifested in unlimited forms and expanded incarnation. Gopala Tapani Upanishad 1.21. The Brahma Samhita also 5.1 says, Ishvara Parama Krishna Sachidananda Vigraha Anadir Adir Govinda Sarva Karana Karanam. The Supreme Personality of Godhead is Krishna, who has a body of eternity, knowledge and bliss. He has no beginning, for he is the beginning of everything. Is the cause of all causes. I have to continue, Prabhu?
Continue.
Okay. One more paragraph. Elsewhere, it is stated, Yatra Vartinam Krishna, Krishnayakam Param Brahmam Narakriti. The Supreme Absolute Truth is a person. His name is Krishna. And he sometimes descends on the earth. Similarly, in the Srimad Bhagavadam, we find a description of all kinds of incarnation of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. And in this list, the name of Krishna also appears. But then it is said that this Krishna is not incarnation of God, but is the original Supreme Personality of Godhead himself. Yeah. Continue, Prabhu?
No, that's all.
Okay. Hare Krishna.
So Prabhupada now quotes a lot of verses from Gopal Tapani Upanishad Brahma Samhita stating how Krishna is Supreme Personality of Godhead. Because generally those who are Mayavadis, impersonalists, they believe only in Upanishads. So that's the reason Prabhupada is quoting. And then he quotes this verse from Srimad Bhagavatam, Ete Chams Kalapumsa Krishnastu Bhagavan Sayam Indriyari Vyakulam Lokam Vidyanti Yogi Yogi. So this particular verse is called Paribhasa Sutra for Gaudiya Vaishnavas. Or Paribhasa Sutra of Srimad Bhagavatam. So this verse, it talks about different incarnation. Of Varaha, Kurma, Nrsingha. And then it says, Ete cha amsa kala pumsa. So either these people are Ansa, in the expansion of Krishna, or Kala. Kala means expansion of Krishna. Or they are the Purusha incarnation of the Lord, the three Vishnus. But Krishna's tu Bhagavan Sayam. But Krishna is tu means but. But Krishna is Swayam Bhagavan, Supreme Personality of Godhead. So this particular verse makes position of Krishna very, very distinct from all the previous incarnations, all incarnation of Krishna. So that's why it is called the Paribhasa Sutra of Srimad Bhagavatam. And then later on we find that Prabhupada talks about universal form, and how universal form, first he tells us that it is not the permanent form. It's eternal in the sense it is displayed in different universes. In that sense it is eternal. But then it is exhibited just to please Krishna, please Arjuna. So this is one thing. And second thing Prabhupada writes is universal form is not attractive for pure devotees. Because it causes fear. It doesn't cause the relationship. So in this way, in this particular purport, Prabhupada has practically given the whole process of devotion service. Okay, Sipru had a question.
Hare Krishna Prabhuji. Prabhuji, my question is related to the devotional service or Ananya Bhakti, which is quoted over here, that one has to take up one has to take the shelter of a spiritual master to practice his Ananya Bhakti to achieve the ultimate goal. However, sometimes we have seen, like in Bhagavatam and other places, we get a quote, like some of the devotees, even unknowingly, they have done devotional service. I think, if I'm not wrong, Prahlad Maharaj in his previous life, he had fasted unknowingly, and I think he had fasted and also he was awake the whole night, and due to which he got such an elevated, I'm not sure if this is, I don't remember, quite remember the event. But he gets such a elevated birth. And but here it's quoted that you should do this all in knowledge and especially under the shelter of a spiritual master. So when you do it unknowingly without knowledge, does that not get counted?
So if you remember in one of my previous classes, I explained about Agya Sukriti. So Agya Sukriti means unknowingly we perform devotion service. So that is also counted. That leads to attraction for practicing for the devotion service. Then we collect more and more Agya Sukriti. And when Agya Sukriti creates so much of attraction for devotion service, that one becomes ready to follow the instruction of spiritual master and scriptures. That is the beginning of devotion service, that is called Adav Shraddha. So even in the case of Prahlad Maharaj, he did some Agya Sukriti in the previous life, but then he accepted Narad Muni as his spiritual master in the womb of his mother, and he did so much of sadhana. As long as Hiranyakasipu did tapasya for so many years, Prahlad Maharaj remained in the womb of his mother and heard from Narad Muni. So he did yogic tapasya, Hiranyakasipu, and Prahlad Maharaj did the pure devotion service of Sravanam. And that is how he turned into such a pure soul. So nothing happens easily. Okay?
So, Prabhu, can we say that since Super Soul, Paramatma is the one who is leading you to do the devotional service, even towards the demigods, so when we perform that bhakti also, and later on when we come into praying Krishna, so does that piety also gets counted because we take the shelter of the spiritual master later on, or whatever devotional service that we do towards other demigods, doesn't get counted at all? Okay, so only when you start taking shelter and you do it in knowledge, that's when it all matters.
Yeah. See, one thing is, certainly the mode of goodness is more conducive for accepting Krishna consciousness, but then it is not counted. It's like somebody who has a strong body and strong lungs, for him it is more conducive to do swimming. He can become a very good swimmer. One has good strength and good sleek body and good lungs. But at the same time, that is not a qualification to become a swimmer. for swimming, you have to practice for so many years and then one becomes a good swimmer. So it has nothing to do with swimming. So similarly, other piety may help us to practice devotional service if we start it. But it has nothing to do with devotional services. Okay?
Okay.
Prabhuji, but I have one more question to the same leading question. So, Srila Prabhupada has particularly emphasized in most of the places, no matter what you do, these four regulative principles, and then you're following the injunctions and with the association, unless you have a spiritual master or under a bona fide spiritual master, whatever things that you're doing for devotional service does not count. Is he also trying to imply to those a group of people or impersonalists who have their own conceptions, who have their own judgments and follow devotional service?
Yeah, it's true for Gyanis also. See, what Prabhupada is speaking is basically, when we say spiritual master, means a spiritual guide.
Yeah. Shiksha so, Guru. Yeah.
Shiksha Guru also. So even people who take Bhagavad Gita, when we distribute and they start reading and they start practicing, that is also following Prabhupada. So that's also following the spiritual master only. At the same time, four-day principles help us to come to motor goodness. So that is why we follow four-day principles. Because motor goodness is conducive for practice of Krishna consciousness. And the point which you made about pointing at the Gyanis, that's true. Because Gyanis try to find Krishna on their own through academic study. So that is what Prabhupada condemns at many places. So unless until they take shelter of spiritual master, they can't advance.
Okay.
So Prabhupada. Perfect. So good understand. Right understand. Hare.
Thank you, Prabhuji. Hare Krishna.
Hare. So now we'll go to 55. Mat karma krenda mat paramo mat bhakta sanga varjitaha. Nirvaira sarvabhuteshu yasa mam eti pandava. Please read.
My dear Arjuna, he who engages in my pure devotional service, free from the contaminations of fruitive activities and mental speculation, he who works for me, who makes me the supreme goal of his life, and who is friendly to every living being, he certainly comes to me. Hare Krishna.
So this is Prabhupada. Krishna actually defines pure devotional service here. And Prabhupada has made it much more precise. So one who engages my pure devotional service, free from fruitive activity and mental speculation. Now if you see, Sangha Varjita. Sangha Varjita means contaminated association. But then Prabhupada has explained, he has given the purport even in the word-to-word meaning and the translation also. Free from contamination of fruitive activity and mental speculation. So he has given the definition of pure devotional service very clearly. So that's Prabhupada's expertise. So that is why Prabhupada's translation purports are so important for us. Somebody just goes to Sanskrit, he may not understand things so clearly. And then what he writes? And who makes me the supreme goal of life? Who is friendly to all living beings? So these are the characteristics of Madhyam Adhikari which Prabhupada has written here. Practice of pure devotion service of Madhyam Adhikari. So the definition of pure devotion service and definition of Madhyam Adhikari, Prabhupada has accommodated everything here in this particular translation. And then further he elaborates on pure devotion service in the purport also. So we can again read this purport also. Yeah. Please read the purport.
Anyone who wants to approach the Supreme of all the personalities of Godhead on the Krishna Loka planet in the spiritual sky and by intimately connected with the Supreme Personality of Godhead Krishna must take this formula as stated by the Supreme himself. Therefore, this verse is considered to be the essence of Bhagavad Gita. The Bhagavad Gita is a book directed by the conditioned soul who are engaged in the material world with the purpose of lording it over nature and who do not know of the real spiritual life. The Bhagavad Gita is meant to show how one can understand his spiritual existence and his eternal relationship with the Supreme Spiritual Personality, and to teach one how to go back home to Godhead. Now, here in this verse, which clearly explains the process by which one can attain success in the spiritual activity, devotional service. As far as work is concerned, one should transform his energy entirely to Krishna conscious activities, as stated in the Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu 1.2.255. Anasaktasya vishayan yana yatarharham upayutaha nirbandha Krishna sambandhe yukta vairagya uchyate. Now, work should be done by any man except in relationship to Krishna. This is called Krishna karma. One may be engaged in the various activities, but one should not be attached to the results of his work. The result should be done only for him. For example, one may be engaged in the business, but to transform that activity into Krishna consciousness, one has to do business for Krishna. If Krishna is the proprietor of the business, then Krishna should enjoy the profit of the business. If a businessman is in profession of thousands and thousands of dollars, and if he has to offer all this to Krishna, he can do it. This is work of Krishna. Instead of constructing a big building for his sense gratification, he can construct a nice temple for Krishna, and he can install the deities of Krishna and arrange for the deity service, as it outlined in the authorized book of devotional service. This is all Krishna karma. One should not be attached to the result of his work, but the result should be offered to Krishna, and one should accept as prasadam the remnants of offered to Krishna. If one constructs a very big building for Krishna and install deities of Krishna, one is not prohibited from living there. But it is understood that the proprietor of the building is Krishna. This is called Krishna consciousness. If, however, one is not able to construct a temple for Krishna, one can engage himself in cleaning the temple of Krishna. That is also Krishna karma. One can cultivate a garden. Anyone who has land in India, at least any poor man has a certain amount of land, can utilize that for Krishna by growing flowers to offer him. One can sow tulsi plant because tulsi leaves are very important, and Krishna has recommended in Bhagavad Gita, patram pushpam phalam toyam. Krishna desires that one offer him either a leaf or a flower or a fruit or a little water, and by such an offering he is satisfied. This leaf especially refers to tulsi. So one can sow tulsi and pour water on the plant. Thus, even the poorest man can engage in the service of Krishna. There are some of the examples of how one can engage in working for Krishna.
So this is like a powerful purport, how practically one can perform devotion service. So see, so expertly Prabhupada has given that how everybody can perform. So somebody has a lot of money, he can build a temple for Krishna, install the deities, and then one can live in the temple also. What does it mean? So that is the consciousness, that I am not building my house, I am building a temple for Krishna. And then deities are the proprietor of the house, and I am just a servant of the deities. So if that consciousness is there, that I am just living in the temple and the deities are the owner of the house, then that is pure devotion service. Then whatever activities you may perform, like brooming, that becomes brooming in the temple. Similarly, anything comes, that result is belongs to Krishna. So a servant of Krishna, like servant of a king, works for the welfare of the king. Similarly, One goes out and works and earns money. It is whose money? Krishna's money. So then you offer it to that Krishna, and then as a prasad, one can accept that money and one can engage in the service of Guru and Krishna and the Vaishnavas. So family members also come in the category of Vaishnavas. Then even if you take care of the family members, it becomes pure devotion service. Similarly, anything comes in the house, first it has to offer to Krishna, and then one accepts it as a prasad of the Lord. So in the ancient days in India, that was a culture. So I also still remember from childhood, although we were not like ISKCON devotees, but we had Gopalji and Saligram Sela in our house. So whether it's new clothes or anything new, first it has to be offered to the deities and then accepted. So that was culture in India. So that is how when anything is accepted as prasadam, then it is not entangling, it is liberating. Because the consciousness changes. We understand it is a prasad of the Lord, mercy of the Lord. So similarly, Prabhupada is saying if somebody is poor and he can't make a building, he can't make a house. So somebody doesn't have enough money to have a house, own a house. And one is staying in the rented house. Then what one can do? There are so many temples, especially in India. One can go to a nearby house, nearby temple. And that was made by the king in order to elevate the consciousness of the people. So the people who are poor, who can't own a house, can't make their house into a temple, they can go to these temples and render services. So just go and broom there, serve deities in some way. Similarly, at least one may not have a land also. At least one has a waste in his house. So one can sow tulsi plant and one can offer tulsi to the Lord. And one can worship the tulsi, serve tulsi. So that is how even a poorest man can advance in Krishna consciousness. So this is a very practical way in which Prabhupada has explained how one can perform pure devotion service. And in this way, we can remain Krishna conscious 24 hours a day. So no activities are in the world which can't be used and made Krishna conscious. So that is how even being a grihastha, one can perform pure devotion service. But if this consciousness is not there, to the degree the consciousness it is my property, my people, to that degree, grihastha life is entangling. So, it is just a matter of changing some details and changing the consciousness. That's why you will find in India, in many places, people write their houses, on top of their houses, Krishna Kutir or Radha Kutir, just to explain that it is their house, it is not my house. So unfortunately, what has happened over the time is now people still have that culture. Some people, even that is being destroyed. But they don't understand the consciousness behind that. So if really it is done consciously, then everything can be made pure devotion service. Such a practical way in which Prabhupada has explained. So anybody who reads 54 and 55 purport very nicely, he can get complete understanding of Krishna consciousness. So that is how Prabhupada's purports are so powerful and so meaningful for all of us. Okay. So Madhavendra Karuna Prabhu has a question.
Yes, Prabhu. Hare Krishna, Prabhu. Yes. Prabhu, as you said, this academic qualification, it will not related to Krishna consciousness without truth. So why so many people studying in higher qualification like doctor and all? So what about our children? We have to send from childhood to Gurukula. That is important, or we have to send to the higher qualification, higher education?
Yeah. See, that is a different part of life. And in general, in the Vedic Gurukulas, both the knowledge of the skills and the knowledge of the values was given together. So both the things were given together. Now what is happening is that Prabhupada suddenly, he made all the gurukuls, different gurukuls all over the world. And the goal was that the people who pass out from the gurukul, they will become a part of Vedic Varnasam communities. So for being a part of Vedic Varnasam communities, you need certain skills which are too less, not too much. And that much is taught in the gurukuls of ISKCON. But what actually happened in due course of time is, because we didn't have many Vedic Varnasam communities also, and wherever they were made, they were collapsed. They are successful at very few places. And that too, it's like just a beginning. So because of that, what has happened is that many of the devotees or the Gurukul children who came out, they had to deal with the outside world. So then they didn't have enough skills to deal with the outside world. So certainly, it is Prabhupada's great dream that all the children of our ISKCON, they would study in the Gurukul, and subsequently we will have Varnasam communities, and they are the best trained people for Varnasam communities. We who have already lived a lavish life in the cities, we can't be a part of Varnasam community now. People come to our Gosala here where I'm staying. No, they are bitten by the mosquitoes and they run away. So many people, they are not able to tolerate now. So, but this Gurukul children, they know. So whole model has to come up simultaneously. So currently, it is like things are more in the seed form. So maybe in another 30, 40, 50 years, hopefully, things would be grown up properly. But till then, Grahastha community devotees, they have to see on their own that how much risk you can take, how much risk you cannot take. But things are just beginning, actually. They are not like fully fructified now. Okay?
So that means our children's only small education is sufficient, or we have to attend higher academic education, or we have to like that, I'm asking.
So if you can take that risk that tomorrow my children go to Gurukuls of ISKCON and they learn certain skills which are not sufficient for dealing with the outside world, and there is no success to Varnasram communities which we have.
Yeah.
If one can take that risk, then one can send to Gurukuls. If one can't take that risk, then there is another model which many of the devotees are adopting, is that you give them outside skills from the outside colleges. At the same time, there are children classes going on and different things are going on from where they get values also. So certainly in that case, they won't be having the same spiritual education like that in the Gurukul. But then there is lesser risk to the life, in the sense that even if Varnasam communities are not very successful, they can continue.
Oh, so both should be parallel.
So that's what I'm saying. So it depends on how much risk you want to take. So that decision has to be taken. If you can take a risk, just send your children to the Gurukul and let us see, you keep some backup for them. This one way. Another way is, if you don't want to take a risk, zero risk, then give them material education. At the same time, give them values through different value education classes. Like in many of the cities now, they have the children for the communities or the congregation. So they are given their spiritual education also. And then it is CBSE board, ICSE board, or some other boards are there. Uh-huh, so okay. They get both the things.
But as far as sentimentally, if you talk, if you have full faith in Krishna, then where is the meaning of risk? Because we have full faith in Krishna. Okay, you go to Gurukula. So like that, if you think, what will happen?
That's what I'm telling you. It depends on the faith level. So if somebody has really such a faith that, okay, anyway, now even if somebody materially suffers a little bit, if somebody is a Krishna conscious, doesn't matter. Because Sudama was also a devotee. Yudhishthira Maharaj was also a devotee. Janak Maharaj was also a devotee. So all of them were devotees. So now if you ask how much to earn, like many devotees have this question, how much to earn? Sudama without earning was also a devotee. He would remain hungry for days together and he was a pure devotee. And if you say about Yudhishthira Maharaj, he had the wealth of the whole world and he was a devotee. So these things, they matter a lot on the individual. So whatever is needed for one, or whatever can be managed by one, one can accept that. So this is not like a particular instruction which can be a general thing. So whenever it comes to Varnasram, because Varnasram is more on a bodily platform. So such a thing cannot be have a general answer. So that's why that's why we have this mentor system in our ISKCON. That an individual devotee knows you for years together, and then he can give a particular guidelines and direction depending on those things. Okay.
Thank you. Hare Krishna.
Hare Bol. So now we can go further in the purport.
The word mat paramaha reference to one who considers the association of Krishna in his supreme abode to be the highest perfection of life. Such a person does not wish to be elevated to the higher planets such as moon or sun or heavenly planets, or even the highest planet of this universe, Brahmaloka. He has no attraction for that. He is only attracted to being transferred to the spiritual sky. And even in the spiritual sky, he is not satisfied with merging into glowing Brahma Jyoti effulgence. For he wants to enter the highest spiritual planet, namely Krishna Loka, Goloka Vrindavana. He has full knowledge of that planet and therefore he is not interested in any other. As indicated by the word Mad Bhaktaha, he fully engages in devotional service, specifically in the 9 processes of devotional engagement, hearing, chanting, remembering, worshipping, serving the lotus feet of the Lord, offering prayers, carrying out the orders of the Lord, making friends with him and surrendering everything to him. One can engage in all 9 devotional services or 8 or 7 or at least 1, and that will surely make one perfect. The term Sangha Varjitaha is very significant. One should dissociate himself from persons who are against Krishna. Not only are the atheist persons against Krishna, but also are those who are attracted to fruitive activities and mental speculation. Therefore, the pure form of devotional service is described in Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu at 1.1.11 as follows. Anya vilashita sunyam gnana karmadi anavritam anukulena krishnanu shilanam bhakti ruttamam. In this verse, Srila Rupa Goswami clearly states that if anyone wants to execute unalloyed devotional service, he must be freed from all kinds of material contamination. He must be freed from the association of persons who are addicted to fruitive activities and mental speculations. When freed from such unwanted association and from the contamination of material desires, one favorably cultivates knowledge of Krishna. That is called pure devotional service. Anukulasya sankalpaha pratikulasya varjanam hari bhakta vilasa 11.676. One should think of Krishna and act for Krishna favorably, not unfavorably. Kamsa was an enemy of Krishna's. From the very beginning of Krishna's birth, Kamsa planned in so many ways to kill him. And because he was always unsuccessful, he was always thinking of Krishna. He thus, while working, while eating, and while sleeping, he was always Krishna conscious in every aspect. But that Krishna consciousness was not favorable. And therefore, in spite of his always thinking of Krishna 24 hours a day, he was considered a demon. And Krishna at last killed him. Of course, anyone who is killed by Krishna attains salvation immediately, but that is not the aim of the pure devotee. The pure devotee does not even want salvation. He does not want to be transferred even to the highest planet, Goloka Vrindavana. His only object is to serve Krishna wherever he may be. A devotee of Krishna is friendly to everyone. Therefore, it is said here that he has no enemy, Nirvairaha. How is this? A devotee situated in Krishna consciousness knows that only devotional service to Krishna can relieve a person from all problems of life. He has personal experience of this, and therefore he wants to introduce this system, Krishna consciousness, into human society. There are many examples in history of devotees of the Lord who risked their life in spreading the God consciousness. The favorite example is Lord Jesus Christ. He was crucified by the non-devotees, but he sacrificed his life for spreading Krishna consciousness. Of course, it would be superficial to understand that he was killed. Similarly, in India also, there are many examples such as Tukaram Haridasa and Prahlada Maharaj. Why such risk? Because they wanted to spread Krishna consciousness, and it is difficult. A Krishna consciousness person knows that if a man is suffering, it is due to his forgetfulness of his eternal relationship with Krishna. Therefore, the highest benefit one can render to human society is relieving one's neighbor from all material problems. In such a way, a pure devotee is engaged in the service of the Lord. Now we can imagine how merciful Krishna is to those engaged in his service, risking everything for him. Therefore, it is certain that such persons must reach the supreme planet after leaving the body. In the summary, the universal form of Krishna, which is temporary manifestation and the form of time, which dwarfs everything, and even the form of Vishnu four-handed, has all been exhibited by Krishna. Thus, Krishna is the origin of all manifestation. It is not that Krishna is manifestation of original Vishwarupa or Vishnu. Krishna is the origin of all forms. There are hundreds and thousands of Vishnus, but for a devotee, no form of Krishna is important, but the original form, the two-handed Shyama Sundara. In the Brahma Samhita, it is stated that those who are attracted to the Shyama Sundara form of Krishna in love and devotion can see him always within the heart and cannot see anything else. One should understand, therefore, that the purport of this 11th chapter is the form of Krishna is essential and supreme. Thus ends this Bhaktivedanta purport of the 11th chapter of the Srimad Bhagavatam, Bhagavad Gita, in the matter of the universal form. Hare Krishna.
So this particular verses then talk about, Prabhupada talks about the goal, that devotee is not interested in entering in Brahma Jyoti, etc. But he performs the ninefold devotion service. And then he quotes this, Anna Bilasita Sunyam Gan Karmandya Namritam Anukulina Krishnanu Silna Bhakti Ruttama. So this is a definition of pure devotion service. This will be explained in more detail in your Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu class. So he explains that. And then he explains the meaning of Nirvaira. Because Sangha Varjita and Nirvaira both are the qualities which are required for a Madhyama Adhikari. So Sangha Varjita means keeping a distance from those who are non-devotees. And Nirvaira means not being inimical to anyone. And that is how one develops friendship with the devotees and becomes merciful to the innocent people. So Prabhupada gives the example of Haridas Thakur, Prahlad Maharaj, Jesus Christ. So that is how in this particular purport, Prabhupada has given the entire summary of Krishna consciousness. So in this particular chapter, 11th chapter, it is explained that how Arjuna doesn't have to worry and he just has to become the instrument in the hands of Krishna. And it is also explained how the Krishna Supreme Personality of Godhead, by showing Visvarupa Darshan, he is the source of Visvarupa also. He is the source of 400 forms of the Lord also. But the 200 form of Krishna, the Samsundara, is the most supreme one. So that is the summary of chapter number 11. Now, after hearing this particular chapter, Arjuna again wants to confirm very, very clearly and precisely, although he has heard already, Bhaktya Mama Vijanati, that how devotional service is superior to all other yogas. So again, Arjuna wants to make it very, very clear so that there is no confusion for the reader of Bhagavad Gita. So that how 12th chapter starts with. So in this particular chapter, we understand that how bhakti or the devotees are the supreme. So this is being explained. Then progressive level of bhakti are explained. And also the qualities which make us dear to Krishna. What all qualities we are supposed to discuss or develop in order to become very, very dear to Krishna. They are also explained in this particular chapter number 12. So that the summary of chapter number 12. So now we'll start with Arjuna's question. Arjuna vacha evam satade yuktaye bhaktastvam paryupasate te chapi aksharam avyaktam tesam ke yoga vittama. Please read.
Arjuna inquired, which are considered to be more perfect, those who are always properly engaged in your devotional service, or those who are worship the impersonal Brahman, the unmanifested? Hare Krishna.
So those who are your satate yukta ye bhaktas, those who are always engaged in performing devotion service, your devotees. So are they the best? Or sa chapi aksaram vyaktam tesam ye yoga vittama, all the other yogis who are known of Brahman. Because in general, karma yogi, jnana yogi, for them, the greatest goal is entering in Brahman. And those are ashtanga yogis also. Some of them prefer Brahman, some of them prefer going to Paramatma. So among them, who is supreme? Arjuna is asking. So already in 6.47, Krishna made it very clear. 6.46 and 6.47. That how ashtanga yogi is better than karma yogi, jnana yogi. And then 47, Krishna said that how bhakti yogi is better than ashtanga yogi also. See, so already made very clear in 6.47. Yogi nama api sarvesa mandagadin antanatmana. Saddhavan bhajate vimam sama yukta tamumata. That one who does my bhajan beginning with Shraddha, he is the best among all the yogis. Because he is most intimately united with me. So that already Krishna has explained. So now Arjuna asks the similar question now. So now Krishna starts answering in text number 2. So 2 to 7, Krishna explains how personalists are better than impersonalists. Because other yogis in general, they prefer merging in impersonal Brahman. That is their goal. So 2 to 7, Krishna explains that how these personalists who are my devotees are much, much better than impersonalists. So verse number 2. Shri Bhagavan Uvacha Maya Vesha Mano Yemam Nitya Yukta Upasate Siddhaya Parayopetas Teme Yukta Tamamataha. Please read.
The Supreme Personality.
Please carry on, Prabhuji.
The Supreme Personality of Godhead said, those who fix their minds on my personal form and are always engaged in worshipping me with great and transcendent faith are considered by me to be the most perfect.
So Krishna says, among all these people, my devotees is the best. Those who absorb their minds in my Samsundar form, they're constantly united with me, Nitya Yukta. So my aves, those who are absorbed in me, ye mam Nitya Yukta. So they are always Yukta in me, constantly united with me. With faith, which is beyond the gunas. Paryopetas, Sadhaya Paryopetas means their faith is beyond gunas. So this is their faith is not the faith in mode of goodness. Their faith is transcendental, which is beyond the gunas. Whereas other yogis, their faiths are faith in mode of goodness. So because of development of mode of goodness, there is detachment which comes. There is knowledge which comes. So that knowledge leads to detachment, and that knowledge, that's why helps a person to understand that he is not matter, he is spirit. Or I am soul. I am beyond matter. So that is called Brahman realization. So that realization, that's why is considered, or that faith is considered the result of mode of goodness. But this particular faith, it is paraya shraddha. It is not the faith due to mode of goodness. This faith comes through ananya bhaktas. Those who are pure devotees, they have faith in the process of bhakti, and they can give that faith to other people also. That's why this faith is beyond the gunas. It is beyond three modes of material nature. So that's not ordinary faith. So that is how devotees are always better than other people. All the other people may be very renounced, staying in the Himalayas, doing a lot of tapasya, taking bath in the Gangotri, Yamunotri. But even a devotee may be seemingly attached householders, looking like that. But despite that, devotee is very elevated because his faith is transcendental. It is not faith from mode of goodness. That is how devotee is always very superior. And they are called Yukta Atma. Yukta Atma means they are best knowers of the yoga. Because they are most intimately united with the Lord in yoga. And that's very clear. That becomes clear from 11:25-27. I'll write this for everyone. So this particular verse is a proof that how bhakti is transcendental and it is beyond the modes. And the faith, basically we are talking your faith. Faith in bhakti is faith not due to goodness, but due to other devotee or it's beyond gunas. So this verse is as follows. सात्विकी आध्यात्मिकी श्रद्धा कर्म श्रद्धा तु राजसी तामसी अधर्मे या श्रद्धा मत सेवायाम तु निर्गुणा. So this verse, the translation is, faith directed towards spiritual life is in mode of goodness. Faith rooted in fruitive activity is in mode of passion. Faith resided in religious activity is in mode of ignorance. But faith in my devotional service, mat sevayam, Nirguna, that is purely transcendental. It is beyond three modes of material nature. So that is how by any amount of piety which leads to mode of goodness, one cannot get faith in bhakti. Faith in bhakti comes by associating with bhakta. That is why for devotees, very, very essential to again and again take association of devotees. To the degree we will associate with the devotees, especially those who have strong faith, to that degree we will get faith in bhakti. Otherwise, what happens is faith becomes shaken up. So, remaining away from non-devotees and remaining in association of devotees is extremely important. So, generally when somebody associates with non-devotees, one thinks, well, what is so wrong in that? But what happens is, because materialists, they have a lot of faith in sense gratification, unknowingly they also give us faith in sense gratification. But devotees, they have faith in bhakti, so unknowingly they also give us faith in bhakti. So if you want, one wants to develop faith in holy name, associate with the devotees who have a lot of faith in holy name. One wants to have a lot of faith in reading scriptures, associate with the devotees who have a lot of faith in scriptures. If you want to have faith in deity worship, associate with the devotees who have faith in deity worship. So it's a very easy way to overcome different obstacles in bhakti. So any obstacles, if you are able to identify them, just associate with the devotees who have faith in any of these processes. Because a bhakta can only give that faith. Nobody else has that power. So this shows that ananya bhaktas are those who are having bhakti. And this also shows that actually those who have faith in other things also, so they are considered a little inferior. See, for other people also, those who are karma misar bhakta, gyan misar bhakta, yoga misar bhaktas, problem with them is, the problem is that they don't have so much faith in the process, although the goal is very clear. So for all these people, they are very clear with the goal. Their goal is to achieve Krishna and go to Golok Vrindavan or getting Krishna Prem. But they don't have sufficient faith in the process. So that is why those who are Karmasra Bhakta, they feel, okay, along with the Bhakti, we have to perform Varnasram duties very properly. Otherwise, we can't advance. Those who are Gyanamisra Bhakta, they have a faith that unless until we intellectually read all the scriptures properly, we can advance in Bhakti. So their faith is divided. Those who are Yogamisra Bhakta, they think that unless until we do Yam, Niyam, Asana, Pranayam, and we do meditation every day, we can't advance in Bhakti. So that is a Misra. But devotees know that just by practicing devotion service, the Sravanam Kirtanam, we can just advance in Krishna consciousness and there are no obstacles for Bhakti. So that is Ananya Bhakta. So that is how Ananya Bhakta is always superior to the Misra Bhaktas and what to say of other yogis. Okay. Sipru had a question?
Yes, Prabhuji. I just want to understand, we also learnt about all those Mishra Bhaktas in 9th chapter and we ended up with 9.34. We said Yoga Mishra Bhakta, who is the perfect. What is the difference between that Bhakta and this Bhakta? There also he is worshipping the Lord, he is thinking about the form of the Lord and everything. So how? What is the significance of this verse when compared to 9.34?
So I told two things, if you remember. Just now I told about the faith.
Yeah. So there he doesn't have the faith, Prabhuji?
His faith is mixed.
Ah, okay. So here it is steady now. It's already to
here,
a different...
Here is Ananya means, he, this person understands, bhakti alone is enough.
Okay, nothing else.
That, nothing else. Other person, that person thinks, no, no, along with bhakti, we also have to do varnasram duties in order to advance in Krishna consciousness. That's why devotees also take the help of karma and gyan till they support our pure devotion service. For example, for grastas, they may have to earn and bring money and maintain the house. Why? Because if body is healthy, family members' health is okay, then we can advance in bhakti. But he doesn't think that unless until I take care of my family members and other things, I won't advance in bhakti. I take care of family members. I do the same activity which that person is doing. Details may be same. So I also take care of my family members very nicely. Why? Because they're devotees. Not because that is, you know, unless until I do that, that is not bhakti. Or I want to make them devotees if they are not devotees. So either of the cases. Similarly, I also have to earn in order to maintain my health and everything. Why? Because, again, no, because it is a part of my bhakti. I am servant of Krishna, who is the owner of the house, and I have to earn for his service. Otherwise, his service will get disturbed. Whereas that other person, he thinks, no, no, this is unless until I do that, I will not advance in bhakti. So the difference in understanding and conviction.
Yeah. So can we give an example here or is my example wrong? Let's say, can we take Yudhishthira Maharaj as under 9.34 and Sudama here in this one?
No.
No?
Yudhishthira Maharaj, both of them are pure devotees, holy Ananya Bhaktas. Why? Because Yudhishthira Maharaj never wanted to accept a kingdom.
Correct.
It is Krishna who wanted Yudhishthira Maharaj to become the emperor of the world. Similarly, Prahlad Maharaj never wanted to become a king. It is Narsingdev who wanted Prahlad Maharaj to become a king. So that's why these people, they have accepted kingdom. So we can accept the entire facilities of the entire creation if Krishna wants it. So for his service, we can use anything. But for our own sense gratification, we don't accept a single thing. So that is a devotee.
Got it, Prabhuji. Thank you. Hare Krishna.
And also, in detail, I'll tell one case study where it will become very clear. If you remember the example I gave of Bhakti Sansarasati. the Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati told one of the devotees that for coming for my Vrindavan Yatra, you can speak a lie to the boss.
Correct. Yeah, yeah.
So if you remember that example, it is very clear.
Yeah.
So now we'll come back to text third and fourth. Ye tvi aksharam anirdesyam avyaktam paryupasate sarvatragam achintyam cha kutastham achalam dhruvam sanyam men diagramam sarvatra samabuddhaya te prapuvanti mameva sarvabhute hite rata. Please read.
That those who only worship the unmanifested, that which lies beyond the perception of the senses, the all-pervading, inconceivable, unchanging, fixed and immovable, the impersonal conception of the absolute truth, by controlling the various senses and being equally disposed to everyone, such persons engaged in the welfare of all, at last achieve me.
So those who worship my impersonal sarupa as Brahman are inferior because of their suffering state. So that Lord states in these two verses. Those who worship, and in the next two verses, Lord says, those who worship Brahman, Aksharam, which is anirdesyam. Anirdesyam means it cannot be given a designation. It is avyaktam. Avyaktam means it has no form, no qualities. Sarvatgam, it is spread everywhere. Achintam, you can't do chinta, you can't do apply any logic to it. Kutistham, which extends all over the time. Achalam, where divide or increases, divide of any increase, it remains as it is. Dhruvam means it is eternal. So these people, they also attain me in the terms of impersonal Brahman. Because impersonal Brahman is also the aspect of the Lord only. So that is what Krishna is emphasizing here. That they also achieve me. Why? Because Brahman is my part only. It is my effulgence. But then how that is not so very superior. So devotees also achieve me, my personal form or personal relationship with me. And Brahmavadis also achieve me in the terms of entering in my Brahma Jyoti. But how they are inferior is explained in text number 5 and 6. So, fifth number. Kleso adhika raste sam avyakta sakta cheta sam avyakta hi gatir dukham dehe vadvir avapyate. Please read.
For those whose minds are attached to unmanifested impersonal future of the Supreme, advancement is very troublesome. To make progress in the discipline is always difficult for those who are embodied.
So this explains first reason why they are considered inferior. So avyat asakta testam, those are attracted to only Brahman. Avyakta, avyakta means Brahman, which doesn't have a form. They desire only Brahman realization. So they are getting only Brahman realization, not the Paramatma and Bhagavan realization. At the same time, they have to undergo a lot of difficulties. So that goal is attained by jivas endowed with bodies, dehadvi, only by undergoing suffering, dukkham. So why there is dukkham? The first reason is the senses have power for particular knowledge such as sound, not for something which doesn't possess any qualities. You are supposed to develop attraction for something which is devoid of qualities, devoid of any form. So Brahma Jyoti has no form, no qualities, and one is supposed to love Brahma Jyoti. So difficult actually. So that's why it is very difficult for them. Second thing is they have to stop their senses. Devotees doubted the senses. Those who are Brahmavadis, they stop their senses. So stopping the senses is very, very difficult. So they can't enjoy good food. For devotees also, they are not supposed to do sense gratification. But if there is a desire for sense gratification, let us say desire to enjoy good food, then at least one can offer to Krishna, accept it, fine, it may not be like a done so consciously or so purely, because we are not doing it as a service. We don't accept gulab jamun as a service and keep in our mouth. So we may not have that consciousness. But even if there is a low consciousness, at least gross senses are pacified. And second thing which happens for the devotees is that the desire also becomes slowly molded and purified. Because if senses are unsatisfied, there is a great chance that they will look towards sense gratification. That is, chances of becoming diverted for a Brahmavadi is much more than that for a devotee. Because you're not enjoying, and suddenly a chance comes, very difficult to control. So for them, there is a lot of mental distress which they have to undergo as compared to for the devotees. Like we take darshan of the deities, which are so beautiful. Now for Brahmavadis, they have to sometimes meditate on the burning corpse, burning dead bodies. So they go to the burning ghats, they meditate how no use of putting so many shampoos in the hairs, ultimately they'll be destroyed in a moment. No use of putting so many creams on the skin, because skin will burn so quickly. No use of going to the gym and building the muscles, because the fat and the muscles will be dissolved so quickly. So that is how they are, that is their meditation. So such a tough thing to do, sit near the dead bodies and meditate. And devotees just go and they meditate on the deities in the temple, which are so beautiful. So that is why their path, both their path of achieving a personal Brahman is very, very difficult. As compared to that, bhakti is kevala ananda kanda. So fine, we may have to get up early in the morning, which is difficult. But after getting up, what do we do? After getting up, we just chant and dance. We don't have to pay a single coin, single money for dancing. They also have to get up early. But what they have to do? Take a cold bath, sit in meditation, and meditate. So meditating is more difficult than just chanting and dancing, which is more pleasurable. That's why sometimes bhakti may be looking difficult, but it's much more pleasurable than any other yoga process. So certain austerities are there till the senses become trained. But once the senses become trained, bhakti looks so easy. And it is so such a pleasurable thing. So that's why this path is much, much superior to any other path. So sometimes it's why even devotees, you know, they become a little confused. Or new people become confused when they see devotees. Like first time I came to ISKCON and I saw this cake prasad. And I even never ate cake in my life, because, you know, generally we know that cakes have eggs. And in our home, they didn't used to take even onion garlic. So even that was not cooked. For me, somebody gave me cake prasad. It was such a puzzling thing. Are you ISKCON devotees? No, you say Krishna Bhaktas and you're taking this cake. Okay, no, this is an eggless cake. I told you don't know. In outside world also, they say eggless cake and they still put the egg. They know it is made by devotees. So for me, prasad, we generally we have either laddu or something, that is what we distribute to others. Or in North India, they have bhandaras. Bhandaras, they generally give puri, sabji, and some halwa. So that is the Bhandaras. But first time cake prasad. Shock of that was Chow Mein prasad. And then I started hearing certain things which I never heard in my life. Nah, lasagna. No, lasagna is something, I thought it is maybe some city. But then I came to know that no, this is also some dish which devotees eat. So outside sadhus, when they see ISKCON devotees, they think no, ye toh pakke, no, they cannot be devotees. No, they are doing a sense gratification in the name of bhakti. So that is how bhakti process is so easy. So sometimes devotees in a race prove such a problem in practicing bhakti. Go and see other yoga paths. But they have to be genuine also. So if there are genuine yoga paths, they are extremely difficult. They are extremely austere. Compared to that, bhakti is like such a easy path. Rather, sometimes I find that devotees, even if you talk in terms of sense gratification, they enjoy more than outsiders. So outsiders also don't enjoy so much. Many devotees have an experience. They never traveled as much as they traveled after coming to bhakti. So outside people make so much plan that I'll go to this hill station here, there. And after coming to devotion service, this yatra, that yatra is going on sometimes here, sometimes there. Similarly, festivals. So many festivals. So practically speaking, some months, like you know, this month is practically filled with all festivals only. So that is how bhakti is very enjoyable process as compared to other yoga processes. So anyway, and ISKCON devotees don't have to be convinced about it. Still, we'll read the verses. So now text number 6 and 7.
येतु सर्वाणि कर्माणि मयि सन्न्यस्य मत्परा अनन्येनैव योगेना मां ध्यायन्तु पासते तेषाम् अहं समुद्धर्ता मृत्यु संसार सागरात् भवामि नाचरात् पार्था मय्या अवश्यत चेतसाम् प्लीज रीड
But those who worship me, giving up all their activities unto me and being devoted to me without deviation, engaged in devotional service and always meditating upon me, having fixed their minds upon me, O son of Pritha, for them I am the swift deliverer from the ocean of birth and death. Hare Krishna.
So, even if my devotee doesn't have so much of gyan, so much of knowledge, so much of intelligence, if he does ananya neva yogena, means one performs ananya bhakti. So what happens to that ananya bhakta or keval bhakta? He comfortably attains liberation from sansara. So getting rid of birth and death is very, very easy for the devotee. So having given up, sannyas basically means here giving up, all other processes for the purpose of attaining me. So one who has given karma, gyan, yoga, sense gratification, everything for attaining me, they worship me by ananya yogena, by ananya bhakti, which divide off karma, gyan, tapasya, everything. So then for those devotees, what I do? I personally deliver them from the ocean of sansara. So that is the method. So for other people, they have to work so hard to get Brahmajyoti. But those who are my ananya bhaktas, I personally deliver them. Tesam aham samudarta mrityu sansara sagara. So this ocean of nisense, the birth and death. So I personally take him up. And then Krishna says, and I do it very quickly. Bhavamina chirat partha. So I can't wait for a long time for these devotees. So I personally become very much impatient. And I deliver them from the ocean of birth and death. So that is how ananda bhakti is so powerful. And that has a great logic also. Why? Because simple thing is that ultimately we have to be trained to become the residents of Golok Vrindavan. And what do the people of Golok Vrindavan do? They ultimately perform Ananya Bhakti. So when one is habituated to perform Ananya Bhakti, he is already trained to become resident of Golok Vrindavan. Then why to keep him here? Why to keep him in the material world? So that is how Krishna very swiftly delivers them. Whereas other people have to do a lot of homework. Entering in Brahma Jyoti and... So they are not habituated to this practice. So that is how bhakti is superior to karma, jnana, yoga, all these processes. So that is what Krishna explains. So now we'll take the eighth one. Maye mana adatsva mai buddhim niveshaya. Niveshyasi maye vet at urdhvam na samsaya. Please read.
Just fix your mind upon me, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, and engage all your intelligence in me. Thus, you will live in me always, without a doubt. Hare Krishna.
And Krishna gives two instructions to Arjuna to fix his mind on Krishna, not on the impersonal Brahman, and fix intelligence also on Krishna, not in the impersonal Brahman. So Krishna says, since bhakti is the best, so please perform bhakti. And how to perform bhakti, Krishna explains in these three verses. So Lord says, the word eva excludes the impersonal aspect of the Lord. Concentrate your mind on me only. Remember only me. Mai eva man adhasa. So concentrate your mind on the Samsundar form. Wearing the yellow cloth, the forest garland, not on the impersonal Brahman. And fix your intelligence in discriminating between what is favorable for Krishna consciousness and what is not favorable for Krishna consciousness. Fix your intelligence based on scriptures. So everybody uses intelligence, whether devotee or non-devotee. But non-devotees, generally they use their intelligence in discriminating between what is favorable for my sense gratification, what is not favorable for my sense gratification. But devotees see things based on scriptures. So such a contemplation is called manan. So that is how and then Krishna says, such a person will come to me without doubt. So how does devotees discriminate? So even after coming in Krishna consciousness, devotees are trained like that. So I don't know whether I told you this particular past time. Okay, I didn't tell. So long before, almost 14, 15 years ago, I was hearing one class by the Radha Gopinath Prabhu in ISKCON Jaipur temple. So he was telling one incident, a funny incident. So in his congregation, one devotee came to him. And he told that, Prabhuji, no, I want to talk separately to you. So then he told, no, you can ask question in the class. He told, no, it's a very personal thing. I can't ask in the class. So after the class, he met this devotee. And he was really upset. Really upset. So he was telling, Prabhu, jab se bhakti mein aaya hai, aapne humko bandh ke rakh diya hai. So since the time I have come to bhakti, you have really tied me up. So then he said, why? He said, now, earlier I was so free. Now, whenever I eat something, I have to see whether it is prasad or not. Whenever I see something, I have to see whether it is Krishna consciousness or not. Whenever I hear, I have to see, it should not be movie music, it should be kirtan only, bhajan only. And he said, today there was an epitome of everything. When I was coming for your class, and I was in my car with a high speed, and suddenly one boy came in front of it, and I had to apply brakes, and this boy was about to die, but somehow he didn't die, and I was really upset. Now these people, they don't know how to follow traffic rules, and we have to be careful. So I was really very upset. I came out of my car and I was just about to speak something in Shuddha Sanskrit. You understand Shuddha Sanskrit? You want to speak something which is not desirable. You know, all that desire was there, but somehow I had to control myself. Why it is not conducive for bhakti? You're telling such a bound life, Prabhu. No, you people have bound me actually. Bandh ke rakh diya aap logon ne. So then Radha Gopinath Prabhu said, now you are totally Krishna conscious 24 hours. Because you are always seeing what is conducive for bhakti, not conducive for bhakti. So please give me test of your lotus feet. So that is how one uses one's intelligence based on scripture. So this is a intelligence trained by scriptures. So if we don't read the scriptures, certainly it becomes trained in opposite way of seeing how something is conducive for sense gratification, not conducive for sense gratification. So, but if we come to bhakti, we read and hear, then our intelligence becomes trained in what is favorable for Krishna consciousness and what is not favorable for Krishna consciousness. So that is how one thinks about Krishna and uses mind in Krishna service, and by hearing about Krishna and reading and contemplating the scriptures, one trains one intelligence in a spiritual way. So that is the way of advancing in bhakti. So we have done up to verse number 8, and possibly 12 verses are remaining, which we'll cover in the next classes, in the next class, and the last class we'll reserve for Patan Prayojan. So there were certain important things which were remaining, because we are just going with the flow. So certain things may be have to address. So that we'll do in the Friday class. So now about 16-17 minutes are remaining. So I have to do two things. One is your questions, and second thing is I also have to tell about OBA. So how to write open book answers. So quickly we'll take a question for another 5 minutes, and then I'll tell about OBA. And then remaining questions we'll take afterwards. So Dinu Damodaran Prabhu.
Hare Krishna Prabhu.
Yes.
Prabhu, in 12.2, we can see here, we can notice that Krishna is saying that personal form is more better than the impersonal form. Mm-hmm. He is confirming that it is personal form that is more important. So when we look into this population or the education wise, the Mayavadis are more prominent in those days, even when Krishna Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was also present. Those days also, even Chaitanya Mahaprabhu has taken sannyasi from a Mayavadi guru only. So that indicates that Mayavadis were very prominent, and even now they are very prominent. So this sloka 12.2, it is really saying that my personal form is more is always worshipable, and it is personal form is very important for devotees. So how do these Mayavadis twist this sloka and tell that it is impersonal?
So actually, in the scriptures, both the personal and impersonal aspects of the Lord are being spoken. So then there are Mayavadis, and then there is followers of Madhvacharya. So what Madhvacharya would do, he was very expert. He did the opposite of what Shankaracharya did. So Madhvacharya, what he did is, that even those verses which would talk about impersonal, through his grammar and logic, he would present them as if they are personal. So that means he said that how personal aspect of the Lord is the only important thing. So he was super expert in that. Because Mayavadis also do the same thing. So there is something called Mukartha and Gonartha. Mukartha is the direct meaning and Gonartha is called a side meaning or indirect meaning. So actual rule of the grammar is that when direct meaning of the verses doesn't have any sense, then we go to the indirect meaning. So if you remember, I gave an example of Gangayam Ghosa. Gangayam Ghosa means, Ghosa is a village of cowherd community, and Gangayam means inside Ganga. So can a village exist inside the Ganga? No. That means we understand it is near to the Ganga. Similarly, there is another word which is used in Prabhupada's purports is that Singo Devadattaha. The Devadatta is a lion. Now, if the storyline is going on, the Devadatta is a king. And now a particular verse comes in between which says Devadatta is a lion. Then we understand that there was nothing like nothing like transmigration suddenly turned into a lion. Then we understand that he has lion-like qualities. So that is called Gonars. Now in the scriptures, they mention both personal aspects and impersonal aspects. So there is direct meaning to scripture, Mukharth, and there is Gonarth also. So what Mayavadis do is, they already are convinced that God has to be impersonal only. And then they twist the meaning of those verses through grammar, which talks about impersonal meaning. So that is how they present. And opposite was done by Madhvachar, just to teach them a lesson. So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, when he met with Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya, he said that why are you not taking the meaning of scriptures clearly? So he said that scriptures are as clear as sun and your purports are like the clouds on that sun, which is not allowing them to be visible. So that is actually done by Shankaracharya. But those Shankaracharya's personality was so attractive because he was just a 7-year-old boy who came with a commentary of Sarirak Bhasya. And the commentary on Bhagavad Gita. So when a 7-year-old boy starts speaking something, generally he becomes very attractive. And that was incarnation of Lord Shiva only. So who did interpret this Mayavad philosophy on the instruction of Lord Vishnu? So because of that, sometimes people do doubt words of Shankaracharya. But then this Mayavad is thinking, how can Shankaracharya be wrong? So that is how they accept it. Okay.
Okay.
Anupru had a question.
Yeah. Hare Krishna Prabhuji, Thandavan. Prabhuji, in the last chapter 1155, we hear from the purport like even in the spiritual sky, he is not satisfied with merging into the glowing Brahma Jyoti effulgence. For he wants to enter the highest spiritual platform, namely Krishna Loka or Golok Vrindavan. And because he knows everything about the Krishna Loka. So here we are talking about the devotees, or devotees, how they can merge into the Brahma Jyoti.
Okay. So what Prabhupada is basically presenting is that devotees are not interested in Brahma Jyoti.
Okay. But he will not merge. He will transcend that.
Certainly. There's no question about it.
Okay.
But why Prabhupada is speaking such a thing is just to compare.
Okay.
It is just to compare with the goal of impersonalist.
So Prabhuji, in the same purport, we see the purport, right? The pure devotee does not even want salvation. He does not want to be transferred even to the highest planet, Golok Vrindavan. His only objective is to serve Krishna, whatever he may be. So, but we also hear from Prabhupada, like finish all your business in this lifetime and go back to home, that one. Because we hear some devotees who want to serve Krishna even in the lifetimes, not this life, next life, next life. But we hear from the Prabhupada also, no, finish all your business in this lifetime and go back to home, back to God. So what is more, like we need to finish this business and go back to home, or we need to serve Krishna even in the further life?
So different things appeal to different people. So for initially, because the people are distressed, so for them, the goal is told that go back home, back to Godhead. Yeah. So that is what is more appealing to the people, and that is why Prabhupada would emphasize on that. So Prabhupada would say, now finish off your business, go back home, back to Godhead. Don't remain in this miserable place. And that is what will appeal to the people in general. Only after advancing in Krishna consciousness for many, many decades, 30, 40, 50 years, then one comes to the platform where Krishna Prem is the only goal. So actual truth is the goal is Krishna Prem. Goal is not to go to Goloka Vrindavan. So Prabhupada is basically, actually Prabhupada when he gives his purport, he just quotes the meaning of the verses. So there's a verse in Bhagavatam. We say Saloka Sarupya Samipya Sarupekam Eva Apyuta Diyamanam Na Gananti Vina Mat Sevanam Jana. That my devotee, if he doesn't get an opportunity to serve, he rejects all the personal liberations also. It is not talking about Sayuja Bhukti in this particular verse. It's talking about four personal type of liberation. But my devotee rejects them also if he doesn't get an opportunity to serve. So why devotees want to go to spiritual world? Because one gets service of Krishna. So that is the main goal. So that's what Prabhupada has translated. So actual goal for us is Krishna Prem. So Krishna's, who are we? Who is Krishna? What is our relationship with Krishna? It's called Sambandha Gyan. How to achieve our goal is called Krishna Bhakti. That is our Avidya Gyan. And Krishna Prem is Prayojan. So the goal of life is to get love for Krishna. Goal of life is not to go to Goloka Vrindavan. Because if you have love for Krishna, Krishna says, stay here, we can stay here. Krishna says to go anywhere, devotee is ready to go anywhere. But that may not be very appealing to the new people. And even for sometimes our stage also. Like sometimes, no, when we, every day in our temple, we recite the Sikshashtakam. So, na dhanam, na janam, na sundarim, kavitame, jagadish, kame. That is still digestible for devotees. But mom janmani, janmani, sware. Some devotees, no, speak with such a difficulty.
Yeah.
And, are my Lord, you know, already the janma is so miserable. no more coming back. So, that's why. For us, it may be not be very appealing. So that's why Prabhupada would emphasize, go back and back to Godhead, go back and back to Godhead. But when we are fully convinced that there is no pleasure in this world, we are devoid of desire for sense gratification. So that time, the clear goal is Krishna Prem. Krishna wants me to stay here, I'll stay here.
Okay. But here one thing, Prabhupada, when Krishna wants to say, yeah, this will look appealing. Like in whatever situation we are, we need to serve the Krishna. That's our only goal. But when the other things influence, like in the material, like whatever happening in the outside and everything, so it will, some or the other way, it will impact even the Lakshmi, or even if we want to serve, we need to also take care of family. For taking care of family, we need to also, so many difficulties we need to pass. So at one time, you will also get this, how much difficulty it is to stay here and serve Krishna. Because serving Krishna is something different. But you cannot, it will be Mishra Bhakti, like you are also thinking about the family, you are also thinking about other things. You cannot be concentrated completely pure on the goal of Krishna, because somewhere or you are compromised. So you will always, it will be difficult to concentrate on the main pure Bhakti.
So that is why, actually, if we see even Sikshashtakam talks about the progressive realization of a devotee through various stages. So the first verse of Sikshashtakam does talk about extinguishing the miseries. Cheto darpan madanam bhava maha davagni nirvapanam. So initially that is only appealing. Bhava maha davagni nirvapanam. So that is the beginning.
But slowly the consciousness or the emotions of a devotee change. That is how we move from first verse of Sikshashtakam to the eighth verse of Sikshashtakam. So the final goal is Krishna Prem. Aslisya va padaratam pinashtuma madasanan marmatam karutu va yatha tatha va vidhatu lambato mat prananasastu saivanam. My dear Lord, whether you embrace me or you don't appear in front of me. So in this way you reject me, but I'll always unconditionally serve you. So that's Krishna prayer. So that may not be appealing initially. That's why for all of us, actually speaking, we are all beginners only. So that's the truth.
Yeah.
So now, even if you have practiced for 10, 15, 16, 17, 20 years, we are all beginners. I'm very clear, I'm a beginner. So that is how, so that is what appeals to us. Stretching of the mental miseries.
Yeah.
So only after Anarthanavitti, so till Anarthanavitti, verse number 1 and verse number 2 of Sikshashtakam is applicable for all of us. So after one gets to the level of Nishtha, which comes after many, many decades of practice. No lust, envy, pride, greed is there inside the heart. After that, the point comes when person talks about no, Trinadapi Sunichena, Tarurapi Saina, Mani Namani. Till then, it is only sadhana. It doesn't become natural for us. So that natural humility comes only after one goes through struggle of all the anarthas, and then one understands, my God, so much of anarthas are inside. So then one becomes humble, and then one becomes tolerant. So it's a long process. Although it's very short in terms of compared to other yoga processes, because it's only one life. But despite that, it's a long process. So have some patience.
Thank you, Guru.
Okay. So Madhavan Karunapuru has a question, but only thing is Madhavan Karunapuru, we are thinking is we'll take first OBA and then maybe you can continue with your question so that other devotees who want to go, so they will be able to attend. So I'll just share about OBA. So first what I'll do, I'll show a sample question. This may take another 10-15 minutes, but that will make it very easy for you. So just wait a minute. And then we can have questions regarding OBS. So all of you can see the screen. So this is the answer which I personally wrote in my Bhakti Vaibhava classes. So where is the Bhakti Vaibhava answer? So I'm very comfortable to show also. So I got very good marks. So I'm very clear that is a good answer. I got about 90% in all my OBAs. So this is a question. You have been asked by a publishing company to write a foreword for a book entitled 10 Steps to Perfect Leadership. So derive ancient principle from the character and activities of Prithvi Maharaj and show their relevance to the modern audience. So if you see, first I have written introduction. an introduction, I paraphrase things on my in my own words, and I wrote the reference also. You can see the reference. So that is how we have to write the reference. So you can see the introduction. Since it is stated in the Veda, the Supreme Personality of Godhead is the maintainer and leader of all living entities, the king or the executive head of the government must be representative of the Supreme Person. Prithu Maharaj was preaching the supremacy and glories of Supreme Personality of Godhead Vishnu. He was therefore a proper representative of the Lord. So here we can see, so we have to not just quote, we have to write in our own words, and we have to give proper references. So these are two serious mistakes which devotees have made. This is what Maharaj Prabhu told me. That some devotees have just quoted from Prabhupada and their whole answer is as if Prabhupada has given the answer. So what they have done is, they have just put the quotations of Prabhupada and they have submitted the answer. So very expert. So they have done copy paste of everything and they have submitted the answer. So we don't want to read Prabhupada's answer. We want to read or your answer. Because OB is meant to check the understanding of a devotee. So you can write your own understanding, but then it has to be written in your own words. Certain Sanskrit texts can be quoted as it is, or certain translation, but majority of the things have to be your understanding of the Prabhupada's quote. And whenever we are quoting from Prabhupada, devotees must give proper references. Reference carry a lot of marks. Almost sometimes 30 to 40% of the marks. So if references are not there, you won't give marks. Because one of the goals of Bhakti Shastri is to teach devotees to present the things authentically from the scripture. So there's something which we are expecting devotees to learn from Bhakti Shastri class. To make sure that we don't speak from our mental speculation, but from scriptures. So this particular quote is given. So for all the devotees, it would be BG, let us say 4.21p in case of purport. So BG would mean Bhagavad Gita. Fourth will be chapter, 21 would be a verse. And P means purport. If there's no purport, don't write P. So just BG 4.21 and the bracket. So that is the way of giving the references. So that is how we have to write the introduction. So these are two mistakes with devotees. And the third mistake which our Maharaj Prabhu was pointing out is many devotees have not read question properly. So what he had asked is, what was asked in the question is that write about Prabhupada's mood and mission from the preface. It's very clear that we have to write from the preface. But many devotees, what they have done, they have written Prabhupada's mood from Chaitanya Charitamrita, Srimad Bhagavatam, Prabhupada Leelamrit. So from everywhere except the preface. So although it was very clear that you have to write the mood of Prabhupada from preface only. Like if you see here in this particular question, what is written? That derive ancient principles from the character and activities of Prithu Maharaj and show the relevance to modern audience. That means we have to write that. Not that now you start writing the principle of character from Dhruva Maharaj and Prahlad Maharaj and Yudhishthir Maharaj. So when it is written Prithu Maharaj, it has to be Prithu Maharaj. So that is, so if we write a subheading, it becomes very clear. You are seeing here? So what I did is basically, I just wrote a subheading from the question only. So that it is very clear for me. And then I wrote point was answers. And here also references are there. So the reference, then there is a relevance to modern audience, which was asked in the question. So the principle from character and activity of Prithu Maharaj, written here. Relevance to the modern audience, that is written here. So one point and then relevance. And that was supposed to be my understanding. So then I wrote my understanding. So these are all my words and my understanding. So that's basically application for people in general. So similarly, when personal application is asked, it has to be application for me, not for others. So then don't write that now for devotees in general, they do like that and that is the application. No, when it is for me, it is for me. And here it has to be written for modern audience, it was for modern audience. Similarly, secondly also you can see. So I wrote some points from purports, then relevance to the modern audience. Third point from the purport, relevance to the modern audience. So you are seeing here. So in this way, I wrote all the 10 points. And at the end, there is a conclusion, which is like a conclusion of my answer. Only a Western leader can fulfill all the desires of the people because he is Vanjakalpadaru and is compassionate because he is the contributor of greatest benefit to the human society. So Prithu Maharaj was such a leader, and modern day leaders can follow in his footsteps and become perfect leaders of their society, of the society. So clear? So read the question very carefully, divide it into parts, write proper references from Prabhupada's translations, purports, and wherever practical or whatever application is required, do the needful. So that is how answer becomes very easy. So now I can take questions. Yeah. So first I want to take questions based on this OBA. Okay. Nandimukhi Mataji had question on OBA.
Hare Krishna Prabhu. From that Prabhupada quotes book, like, should we write only a part of it or should we write full? Because some are very big and it takes so many words. So I just wanted to...
So the point I was making is we don't have to write as it is. So you have to write it your understanding.
Even of the quotes from Prabhupada?
Quote book also. From quote book also, you can write what you have understood from the whole thing. Let us say it is 5 lines, 6 lines. You make it into 2 lines and then just give the reference from the quote book.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah. Then Ravindra Prabhu.
Hare Krishna Prabhuji. Prabhuji, the first unit what we have submitted, can we get a feedback, Prabhu, so that we will know where exactly we are going wrong?
Yeah. So, Maharaj Prabhu will give a feedback. It will take him time to check all the copies. But a general feedback he gave us three things which he told me. One was devotees have not read the question. Some devotees have not read the question properly. Some devotees have not given proper references. And some devotees have just given Prabhupada course as it is without writing in their own language. So these are three feedbacks which he gave them.
And even in the course, we can just start and then put dot, dot, dot. That's enough, no Prabhuji. We can write that.
We can write like that also. Best thing to do is, unless and related Sanskrit words. Within one of my questions, Sanskrit words are required. That has to be exact. But if it is not Sanskrit words, then better to paraphrase it in your own words and write it. Some places, some lines may be extremely powerful. Like one line which is very powerful. Now, like one of the lines which Prabhupada writes it, and one of the purports is that greatness of a person has to be estimated by his ability to tolerate the provoking situations. So these are the line. So then such lines can be quoted as it is. But otherwise, it can be paraphrased and then written so that we understand whether your understanding was right or wrong. So OBA, CBA is for understanding the memory, whether we have memorized properly or not. OBA is for getting the understanding of a devotee. Understand?
Okay.
So Ravindra Prabhu. Then after Maulik Joshi Prabhu.
Hare Krishna Prabhuji.
Prabhuji, in OBA, when the question is to write from specific verses and purport, then you talked about the references. Can we give references from other other scriptures relevant to the question?
We can write that, but then majority has to be from there. It's like 70, let us say, at least 60-70% should be from there. And then other place also we can write.
Okay, bro. And regarding the quotes, we can mention the quote in inverted commas and then we can explain in our own words. That way also we can do?
You can do that, provided you can complete within the word limit.
Okay.
So word limits should not cross.
Okay.
So don't write an answer which a teacher becomes fearful to see. So we don't want to see the Virat Rupa of the answer. We want to see Soma Rupa of the answer. Okay.
Okay. Thank you.
Divya Dhunu, Mataji, Prabhuji. Mataji.
Hare Krishna Prabhu, pranams.
Yes.
Prabhuji, it is a similar question. Like suppose we are asked to write from a particular understanding from a particular verse, but can we quote a similar verse from, for example, from Bhagavad Gita? If a question is coming from a particular verse, can we quote a similar verse from Bhagavad Gita?
Yeah, you can quote. So see, whatever is asked, you should do. Apart from them, something additional from here and there, we can give. There's no harm in that.
In that case, Prabhu, how we can quote, do we have to quote the full sloka along with the translation, or how is it, Prabhu?
Just write some, either some Sanskrit words and ... or you can just write translation in your own words.
In that
and then
case,
after, yes, but Prabhu, reference has to be there. Reference has to be given.
In that case, when we refer then Bhagavad Gita, like for example, 4.9, then we have to write T. T for translation.
No, you don't have to write T. Just write 4.9. Okay. BG 4.9, 4th chapter, 9th verse. Only like, if there is purport, then you have to write P.
Okay. And one more doubt, Prabhu. See, when we write an essay, sometimes we do not mention like introduction and conclusion. Is it mandatory that we have to write introduction and conclusion, or just write paragraph?
So if you want to get marks, so nothing is mandatory. But if you want to get marks, then better write introduction and conclusion.
Okay, that is the word introduction and conclusion should be there, Prabhu. That is
yeah.
Okay, Prabhu. Thank you. Hare Krishna.
See, one very basic principle to score marks, even academically, in outside world. To the degree you make answer easier to that for the teacher, he will make your life easy and he will give good marks. So to the degree it is systematic, it becomes easy for the teacher to understand.
Thank you. Kanchana
Mataji? Kanchana Varan Mataji, yeah.
Hare Krishna Prabhuji, pranams. Prabhuji, I already submitted my OBA, but still I have that doubt, Prabhuji. In the question 9, no, Prabhuji, it is given the points relevant for your personal application. Means we have to find out the points from the purport and the verses which are relevant for application. So that points we have to write, Prabhuji, and we can say like we have to do or one has to do. That point should be there, and then we can give personal application in, I think, one or two line. Is it okay, Prabhuji? Or the full personal application?
No. We have to take out the, let us say, certain Sanskrit words or some lines from the purport. And then just write that, no, how will I apply in my life? So just write personal application, ... or a colon. And then you write a personal application. So if you see, that is what I did in my answer also, which I showed just now. I wrote from Prathumara section, and then I wrote how it is relevant for the modern society. So that's the best way of presenting. Okay, so if you write point-wise, it's better.
But sometimes, Prabhuji, in the same purports, there are many points which we can take. And if we take all that point, we feel all are important. So it is a very difficult choice to make and do, Prabhuji. So like that, sometimes the word limit we cross, Prabhuji, it happens. Means it happened with me.
For word limit, little bit of crossing is okay. Like let us say we ask you 800 words. You write 900 words, is okay. but don't add 1800 words. That's what I'm telling you. So don't show, you know, 200 form is asked, at least show 400 form. Don't show, you know, Virat Rupa. So little bit tolerance is there. It's not that exactly we count word by word. Okay. Nanda Shruti, Mataji.
Prabhu, in the person application, it's written that you have to choose one verse from the section that is given. But for the ninth question, it's written from Chaturshloki. So we can take points from all the four shlokas, only one particular shloka.
No, no, we have to take. We have to take from all the four shlokas.
Okay. Hare
Krishna. Nandi Mukhi Mataji, more question on this, or it's from previously?
Yeah, I had Prabhu. Prabhu, in the same Chatushloki question, the personal application only becomes the main, or explaining the verses becomes the main thing?
So main thing is personal application, but it has to be in terms of the verses.
Okay.
The simple thing is you present the point from the verse, then write a personal application. Then present the point from the verse, then personal application. Simple.
Okay. Thank you.
Kalpana Mataji.
Hare Krishna Prabhuji Pranams. Prabhuji, my question is from the first one. OBA, give reference to Bhagavad Gita 8.14 verse and purport in your response. That means we got to explain that Prabhupada's mode with reference to that verse, or we need to explain the verse and purport what we understood.
So you can write what you have understood based on Prabhupada's modes, etc.
Okay.
And that, then you can write the other things. Yeah.
Okay, because the statement pure devotee, in that we can write about the quality of a pure devotee and the potency of the devotional service, and the rest we can explain about the entire verse also we need to explain, right? The important points of that verse.
You read the whole question again.
Explain in your own words how the statement a pure devotee can live anywhere and create the atmosphere of Vrindavana by his devotional service reflects Prabhupada's mood. Give reference to Bhagavad Gita 8.14 verse and purport in your response.
Yeah. So you take some statements from 8.14, which reflects Prabhupada's moods.
Okay.
And then you can write how a pure devotee can convert. In that you can write Prabhupada's example, your own community example, or here and there. So that's okay. But the reference to 8.14 verse and purport, and from that Prabhupada's mood, how it is being exhibited, has to be very clear.
Okay. Prabhuji, regarding Prabhupada's pastimes, like we can mention his quotes also, we need a specific particular pastime. I mean, I didn't understand, because everywhere he could convert Vrindavan only, because he used to make every environment spiritual. How are we supposed to mention his particular pastime, or the quotes also is okay?
Quotes is okay. See, quotes, maybe say that different type of quotes. Certain quotes are just scriptural quotes. So that has to be very relevant, then we can quote. But some quotes may be like, you know, that all my temples are Vaikunthas, for example.
Yeah.
So that is a good quote to write. So we can add those quotes also. So we can either write pastimes or such quotes. They're okay. Okay.
That response also can be written, no, Prabhuji? When the disciples used to feel they used to be in the spiritual world when they were with Prabhupada. That instance also we can mention, right?
Yeah.
See, what the device when we, disciples...
But when you are quoting, it has to have a reference.
Okay.
Okay, na? So not that now we are just quoting from here and there, because we have heard.
No, Prabhuji, the specific thing I'm asking, because the entire pastime, if you write, that becomes very long, right?
Okay, see, somebody, if you can write pastime in a summary, 1-2 lines, okay, 2 lines, 3 lines.
Okay. Huh.
Or you can write the whole quote, but when you are quoting especially, it has to be have a reference. And better even for pastime also. If you're writing from, let us say, this Leelamrit. So then you can at least write Leelamrit, Prabhupada Leelamrit, and a particular chapter or from where you're written. So fine. To the degree you have references, to that degree your answer becomes authentic.
Okay.
Okay,
okay, Prabhuji. Thank you, Prabhuji. Hare Krishna.
Hare Priya Mataji.
Hare Krishna Prabhuji. Yeah, many things is explained, but I want it in a little more clear, Prabhuji. So,
hey, just a minute. Actually, I think I have muted you. Yeah. Mother, you can repeat again. you are muted.
Yeah, sorry, Prabhuji. Hare Krishna, Prabhuji. Many devotees also asked, you also given the clear answers, but I need a little more detail, Prabhuji. Just I will say, if it is correction, any correction, you please tell me, Prabhuji. The Chaturshloki Bhagavad Gita, first in introduction, we can take the summary of what I understood. Summary of four Chaturshloki. Is that okay, Prabhuji, for introduction?
Okay, it's okay.
And then we have to say that where are the personal application in Sanskrit words. That second step.
Yeah, yeah.
And then third, this one 10.8, what it says in summary. And then what is my application or what is total overall devotee's application we have to write, Prabhuji.
So it is for personal life. See, there are a lot of things given in 10.8, let us say.
Yes.
Both in the verse and the purport.
Okay.
Now you take a particular thing which you feel that has to be applied in my life.
Okay.
Put it there. Either it should be translation or purport, either of them.
Okay.
And then write your own personal application. How you are going to apply it in your own life.
Okay. What I am doing, particularly my experience. Yeah.
What are you going to apply in your life?
What are, okay.
See, it's a application. What means by personal application means, we all need a lot of improvements in our spiritual life. Yes. At least I need. And I feel all devotees need.
Mm-hmm.
So then the purpose is, basically these scriptures we are reading for our own improvement. Mm. How a particular thing you can apply and improve your own practice of Krishna consciousness.
Okay. Each shloka 10.8, what it says and what is my opinion. What it says, what is my opinion.
See, it's not that now you may have to write the whole 10.8. You can write certain things from either translation or purport. And you don't have to necessarily cover everything on 10.8. But at least write one thing from 10.8, one thing from 10.9, one thing from 10.10, one thing from 10.11. At least one.
Okay, one thing and conclusion.
And then conclusion.
Okay. It's clear. Thank you.
Okay. Nandimukhi Mataji.
Prabhu, at least whoever's Prabhuji has corrected, can we get our OBS?
No, Maharaj Prabhu has only corrected. But the point thing is that generally MI rule is that they give it after all the copies are corrected. So it will take him some more time, because understand that no, actually it is almost 80-90 copies. So tough work actually. And especially for brahmacharis, along with all other services, when that has to be done, it takes some time. Every day, 7 hours are spent in our own sadhana. Then existing services are there. On top of that, this particular service comes, it takes some time. So that's why he gave me general feedback. But what he said is it will take him one more week for correcting all the papers.
Okay.
Okay.
Thank you.
Ravindra Prabhu.
Hare Krishna Prabhuji. The question number 5, it says that devotional service reflects Prabhupada's mood. But in the bottom of the question, it says mood and mission. So we have to write both mood and mission, Prabhu?
You can write both mood and mission. Taruni Gopi Mataji, Srinivas Prabhu.
Hare Krishna Prabhuji. Actually, I wanted to ask, other than Srila Prabhupada quotes or something, if we hear from other lectures about the same context, so can we add those points?
I would request stick to Prabhupada for quotes and lectures only.
Okay.
At least for this answer. For our own personal application in our own life, we can hear from anyone got inspired and write. But for MI questions, better to write Prabhupada.
Okay.
Priyanka Mataji, Rakesh Prabhu.
Hare Krishna, pranams Prabhuji. Sorry Prabhuji, my camera is not working. So
okay.
Prabhuji, regarding this, my question 4, I found a very related reference in Back to Godhead magazine. And it is a conversation between Shyam Sundara and Srila Prabhupada in 1972. So can we... such references? Can we give such references?
You can write that.
It's from back.
But you are, so how? So when you write that, what you have to write is no BTG, and then you write the what date of BTG and the article number. That's all.
Okay, Prabhuji.
So whatever we write, we have to write reference basically. That is the main thing.
Okay.
You can write from BTG also.
Okay. Thank you, Prabhuji.
Okay. Ravi Tejapru.
Hare Krishna Prabhu, thanks for the OBA guidance. I have one question from 11.55. Can I ask or later?
Nah, so now, I'll ask whether it's over for everyone. OBA is clear for everyone. So it doesn't seem to be any questions now. So now we can take the questions. Yeah, yes, Prabhu.
11.55, the qualities of devotee, you have quoted Majjhima Adhikari. Then please, can you tell me the qualities of Uttama Adhikari?
Uttam Adhikari is one, Sarva Bhuteshitu Vyapasyat Bhagavati Atmi Chatmana Pasanti Atmani Chatmana Sa is Bhagavat Uttama. This is the definition of Uttam Adhikari given in Srimad Bhagavatam. So Sarva Bhuteshu Vyapasyat, when he looks at all the living entities, Bhagavati Atmani Chatmana, he sees them as part and parcel of Krishna. He sees them as reflecting different qualities of Krishna. Pasanti Atmani Chatmanam. So when he sees everything, every person, and everything in connection to Krishna, such a person is called Uttam Adhikari. So why Madhyam Adhikari has to discriminate? Madhyam Adhikari discriminate between the deities, devotees, non-devotees, and envious. Deities, love for deities. Devotees, so there's Prem, Maitri, Kripa, Upeksha. Prem for Lord, Maitri for devotees, Kripa for innocent people, and Upeksha for those who are envious. So but a pure devotee doesn't discriminate. Uttam Adhikari just gives bhakti to everyone because he sees relationship with everyone.
Okay. Reference, that sloka you chanted, can you give the reference?
Okay, so just a minute if you wait.
Okay,
no, bring my mobile. No, I can show also, just wait for a minute. So it's 11.245.
11.245. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna. So, Madan Karuna Pro. You're not audible, bro.
Hare Krishna,
Prabhu. Now it's audible,
yeah.
Prabhuji, in a previous chapter, I have some general doubt. Are we working in the stock exchange, liquor shop, or meat shop, so they can able to do the Krishna conscious?
One can, but then one is not able to follow the four ID principles, basically. So especially meat shop, because by assisting a person who is killing animals, ultimately we are also killing animals in that way. Similarly, liquor shop, we are also helping a person, in distributing liquor and drinking liquor. So then it comes in breaking four day principles. So that's why it is not recommended. Now, stock exchange when it is concerned, there are different details given by devotees. So I don't know much about stock exchange, really speaking. But what I heard from some devotees is, when it comes to share market and all these things, there are certain shares which are stable, certain are not stable. So depending on what devotees, they are allowed for certain things, not allowed for certain things.
So it is under gambling, no, Prabhuji?
Yeah, so certain things, basic reason why stock exchange is not allowed for devotees, because it creates anxiety.
Because their duty to do, because no other option to earn money. So what is his duty? Because his duty to work liquor shop or stock exchange, then how we can change that his designation? Because his profession is like that.
See, meat eating, meat shop, liquor shop is very clear. There's no question about it. Somebody is working in a brothel, liquor shop, and meat shop is very clear. But when it comes to stock exchange, because I'm a brahmachari, really speaking. So I don't know such practical things. So what I heard from many senior devotees is that there are certain stocks which are don't create a anxiety. They're more like a stable. So then some of them, they don't come in the category of gambling, but anything which creates anxiety for people. Because when you have too much anxiety in people, mind becomes very perturbed. It, you know, goes up and down. It's very difficult to chant. Very difficult to practice Krishna consciousness. Then such things, that's why they are not recommended for devotees. It comes in gambling. But certain things are very expected. So then they say that this is allowed. But for these three things, brothels, liquor shops, and meat industry, it's very clear. So somebody is working KFC and McDonald's, then one has to leave. One should not continue with that job. Okay.
Hare Krishna Prabhuji. Prabhuji, my question is related to the same about spiritual master. Now, when we take the Guru Padashraya, when in case of the spiritual master, that is Prabhupada, and whoever we take the Diksha from, they are trying to liberate the souls that they have taken, that whoever we are taking shelter from. But how does the does Shiksha Guru, apart from showing the direction, do they also go through any kind of austerities for their subjects, or do they what are their services in terms of towards their subjects, Prabhuji?
Actually speaking, Shiksha Guru has more difficult task than Diksha Guru. Now Diksha Guru also has a difficult task. I won't undermine that. Because he takes your karmas, connects to Krishna. But Shiksha Guru is like a personal teacher.
Okay.
So he has to hear all your personal problems, solve them, guide you. So this is a much more difficult task. So Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati glorifies Shiksha Gurus more than Diksha Gurus. So he gives an example of a personal tutor and a class tutor.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
So a class tutor just gives a class and that's all. Personal tutor has to take care of a person personally. So yes. That's why he is considered more important. That's why our parampara is more like a Shiksha Parampara than a Diksha Parampara.
Yes.
Like Bhaktivinoda Thakur. Who is spiritual master? Somebody knows?
Parkeshwar.
Bipin Bihari Goswami.
Bipin Bihari Goswami. But then we see Jagannathas Babaji Maharaj in the picture. We don't see Bipin Bihari Goswami. Similarly, who was spiritual master of Gaur Krishnadas Babaji Maharaj? It is Bhagwat Das Baba. So one Bhagwat Das Babaji is there. But then we find, that's what I remember, Bhagwat Das Babaji. And but we find that Bhaktivinoda Thakur is there. Because he took Shiksha from Bhaktivinoda Thakur. So Parampara, Bhakti Saraswati has emphasized more on Shiksha than Diksha. That's why Shiksha Guru also has a very important part guiding devotees day to day.
Yes, so both are equally they are both guiding. But I just wanted to understand the thin line of how are the duties of a Shiksha Guru different from spiritual master, that is the Prabhupada himself or the whoever we will be taking the Diksha from. There, they help in trying liberating is what you're saying. And here, the Shiksha Guru guides you in the right direction. but spiritually they are guiding you, but rather the subtle, that is the abstract part of liberation, is taken care by the spiritual master, that is whoever gives us diksha. Is that how we have to understand?
Yeah. So that's the right understanding. But apart from that, really speaking, within ISKCON, even Siksha Gurus have to suffer. So some of the spiritual masters, they say, recommending authority has to take 50% karma.
Okay.
So there's no sastric quote for that. So that's why I generally don't speak it. But because your Diksha Guru may not be sometimes seeing you whether you're chanting 16 rounds or not, you're following 40 principles or not, in detail whether you are doing Ekadasi or not. So they generally have trust on recommending authority. And then recommending authority takes a responsibility on behalf of this person, telling to Diksha Guru that, my dear Diksha Guru, I'll make sure this person will continue chanting 16 rounds following 40 principles. I'm very confident about him. And then that is how generally Diksha Gurus, they give the Diksha. So that's why that particular person is not properly guided, and because of that, a person falls down, even the recommending authority has to suffer. So if we do our duties properly, then there's no suffering. Despite guiding, if a person is not taking guidance and falling down, different thing. But one has to do duties very properly. So preaching is very easy. Make devotees, you get a Hari Bol. But after preaching, taking care is a lifelong service. So one has to be, that's why when one preaches, one has to take care also. Both things have to be there. Okay.
Okay, Prabhuji. Thank you. Hare Krishna.
Hare Bol. Yaduvar Govind Prabhu.
Hare Krishna Prabhuji. Dhanat Prabhuji. Prabhuji, this is related to 12.2 when we were speaking about faith. You mentioned that the Sudama and the Yudhishthira devotee regarding the faith who has like Ananya Bhakta. But my question is like when we see the list of 12 Mahajanas, there the Janaka Maharaja is there. But then Yudhishthira Maharaja, even though he is Dharmaraya, but like what was that quality which Janaka Maharaj had to become or qualify as Mahajana than the Yudhishthira Maharaj?
Okay. See, it's not that only Mahajanas are pure devotees of Krishna, others are not. It's not like that. But these 12 Mahajanas, why they are considered authorities? Because they are understood to be great knowers of dharma. They are understood to be the great knowers of dharma. That's why even Yudhishthira Maharaj, although Yudhishthira Maharaj is more closer to Krishna than Bhishmadev in one sense. Because Krishna personally protected Yudhishthira Maharaj, kept him on the throne, and he gave more personal association to Yudhishthira Maharaj than Bhishmadev. But when it came to bewilderment of Yudhishthira Maharaj, he approached Bhishmadev. Because Bhishmadev is a Mahajan. And he knows all the intricacies of dharma, like Sri Dharma, Raj Dharma, all these dharma. So that all comes in the Bhishma Parva and Mahabharata. So it's not just about devotion service, it's about the knowing of the dharma. So all these personalities are more dharmagyas, and they're considered the best in that sense. Okay.
Probably another one is there. It was just striking my mind. So when you were mentioning about the Ananya Bhakta, and like one who has very deep knowledge about the scriptures and the literatures, and one may have the the tendency of doing the more service aspects, but one who has the knowledge, okay, one who doesn't have that much of knowledge, he has to take a shelter of the Shiksha Guru who has that kind of knowledge. But one who has the tendency of doing the service to the devotees and the Lord, but he may not have that kind of the strength of understanding the scriptures. But even though he is taking the shelter of a guru who has this knowledge and trying to progress, but in the due course he may not have capacity to understand the scriptures, then what he should do?
Bhakti doesn't depend on one's capacity. Bhakti depends on one's attitude and whether one is trying to follow best or not. So bhakti is more dependent on one's endeavor than the practical situation. So if you remember, I gave the example of that Brahmana, Sautantra Brahmana, who didn't know how to read Bhagavad Gita properly. But Mahaprabhu appreciated that you have understood Bhagavad Gita. Why? Because you were trying to follow the instruction of the spiritual master to read Bhagavad Gita. So there are pandits around who could recite Bhagavad Gita verses more nicely, give more better explanations. But then this particular devotee, he got love of Godhead and he was crying tears by seeing how Krishna is driving the chariot of Arjuna. So Mahaprabhu said that you have understood Bhagavad Gita. These people are trying to understand, but they couldn't understand. So that's why if we just endeavor from our side. So if Spiritual Master has said, read Prabhupada's books, read whether you understand or not. Hear whether you understand or not. And rest of the time, then we do services. So if we are just doing our part nicely, trying to please Spiritual Master, we are advancing in Bhakti. So Bhakti doesn't depend on results. It depends on one's endeavor and attitude.
Like Srila Rupa Goswami also says in the Nectar of Instruction, that the advancement of Krishna consciousness depends on his attitude.
Attitude, yeah.
Thank you. Thank you, Prabhuji.
Haribo. Okay. Ravita Japu.
Hare Krishna Prabhu. My question related to previous class. His Divine Grace Srila Prabhupada, he holded his breath up to above 70, even though in between heart attacks came and like this. So he could deliver a great service to his Guru Maharaj and also to the humanity. So he never thought this is Dukkalayam. So if he might have thought and he might have gone back, like Guru's body is very most important for all the disciples. He might have gone back before 70s. There might be a major damage to the humanity. So how can the Krishna's yesterday's beginning, you told Krishna's statement, he is the oldest person. He is telling this world is a Dukkalaya. Please, can you explain me relating to the great bhaktas, they are holding up and they are bringing the people to the Krishna consciousness. How we can think?
So when Prabhupada, I was explaining that how Prabhupada was reading this third canto of Srimad Bhagavatam, telling that no attachment to the body is like very much there for human beings and they try to adjust. So basic thing is that Prabhupada was teaching by his example. So the example is Prabhupada was teaching is by hearing the third canto is that this world is Dukkhalaya, which Krishna is saying. And what is definition of Krishna's Dukkhalaya is birth, old age, disease, death is there in this world. Adhyatmik, Adhipodik, Adhidevi class is in there. Now, even if you transcend all the four miseries and the three miseries, still this world remains a Dukkhalaya because that is definition of what Krishna spoke. But then devotees are ready to take that misery for serving Krishna. So it's not that Prabhupada wanted to stay here because this world is Sukhalaya. It is Dukkhalaya only. But he was ready to take that poison for the pleasure of delivering all the other conditioned souls. Like now for a Middle East, Jayapataka Maharaj is one who comes here. So you see Jayapataka Maharaj's body is quite, practically speaking, it's like a burden. But then why is he carrying with that burden? So it's not that he's not getting a misery because of that. But then he's accepting that misery for the pleasure of devotees. So that is how devotees are so great like Lord Shiva, who are ready to drink poison for the welfare of others. But at the same time, the lesson of the whole thing is, so we are not selfish, we are selfless. So that's the main thing.
So until we fulfill our certain responsibilities, we too can take a poison like a poison, and
yes.
we can be pleasure with pleasure in the devotion, sublime Krishna consciousness. We can take it as a inspiration.
Yes, yes, true. Hare so Krishna. Devotees don't live for themselves; they live for others. So it would be very much selfish if you say that I want to stay here because it is Sukhalaya, or I want to leave this place because it is Dukhalaya. But then devotees, they have dedicated their life for the welfare of others. So they are great devotees. So Prabhupada, till his mission was not complete. So first time when Prabhupada had heart attack, so Prabhupada told to the devotees that you pray for me, that my dear Krishna, my spiritual master's mission is not yet complete. So please keep him. That was the first prayer. And Prabhupada was telling that I want to complete my mission. My mission is not complete. When we were in last days in Vrindavan, so when devotees asked Prabhupada, do you have some desire? Prabhupada said, koi ichha nahi hai. I don't have any desire. And then he told devotees to pray. When devotees were very eager that now Prabhupada, we want you back, we want to hold you here. Prabhupada said that you now pray to Krishna that my dear Krishna, we want him. So if you want, you leave him. So they're different from the next prayer. Because Prabhupada knew that he has already accomplished the whole mission, and he had kept the mission in such an automated mode that even if he leaves, mission will spread, it will not collapse. So, okay. So he was eager to meet Krishna, but at the same time, he wanted to fulfill the mission of Krishna and then go and meet Krishna. So that's how he is selfless. At the same time, he wants to please Krishna also. So good question. Thank you, bro.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna. So we'll end here. Srimad Bhagavad Gita ki Srila Prabhupada ki. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna, Prabhu. Hare Krishna, Prabhu. Dandavat Pranam.
Hare Krishna. Srila Prabhupada.